Now Ramdas is going to speak to you about bhakti of the two kinds. One is called Gauri Bhakti, another is called Para Bhakti. Gauri Bhakti is a preparatory bhakti. In this state, the devotee contracts his relationship with God and looking upon Him as master or mother, himself as servant or child, and by trying to realize Him, he struggles day and night to remember Him constantly, and in this effort, necessarily, his mind gets more and more detached from the sense objects of the world. There are so many attractions in the world, so many attachments, he gets loosened. And the mind tries to turn more and more towards God and get engaged in His remembrance and meditation. The struggle at this stage is very painful. Also, out of bhakti springs vairagya. Vairagya is dispassion, a kind of inner recoil towards the object of senses which held him in thrall for so long. After he has gradually got himself free from the clutches of these low desires, he approaches the Divine through complete surrender. And surrender brings about the union of the soul with God to such an extent that the soul loses its individual identity and merges itself in the universal God. And with the result, he knows that in essence he and God are not different. This is called jnana. Jnana or self-knowledge. Knowledge of the self, knowledge of the Atman, Purusha, Shiva or Brahman. But that for the devotee does not seem to the end. He wants to go even further on. He wants to retain his bhakti element in him. He wants to still have the relationship with God as a master or mother and himself a servant and child. And he goes to the state of Parabhakti, in which he beholds the whole universe as the manifestation of his beloved. And after gaining this vision, he still maintains a contact with the Divine and looks upon him as father, as a father, mother, friend, comrade or master, himself as a servant, child or a friend. In this attitude he continues with him even after it attained the vision, a vision of the impersonal, and the vision of the personal as the universal manifestation. That also is a personal aspect, is called Virata Swarupa of God, the universal form of God. But still he maintains a personal relationship with God, looking upon him as master and mother. In this relationship, he maintains a sense of duality with the sole object of enjoying the bliss of communion with God by talk, by singing, by hearing about Him. In this way he maintains that, because if you want to enjoy the bliss of love, there must be more than one. When you lose yourself in the Divine completely and get rid of your individuality, then there's nobody to enjoy the bliss of love through union born of love. So he maintains that relationship. If you become sugar itself, you see, you cannot know the taste of the sugar. You have to become an ant and taste the sugar and enjoy the sweetness of it. So after becoming yourself sugar, you still take yourself separate from it and become an ant and eat it. is just like that. Devotee, after realizing his identity, oneness with God, still remains separate from him in order to enjoy the bliss of union with him through love, which expresses itself in service, in talk, in hearing, in singing about him. This is considered to be by devotees of the highest importance, because the experience which they get by this communion is such that they get a joy so rare, so sweet, that it does not compare with anything else. Even the absorption in him does not get him. Therefore he says, you see, I do not want moksha, O God. I do not want liberation. I want to remain ever your servant or your child. Moksha is not a thing to be achieved. It is there already, because we and he are eternally one. But this relationship is very sweet. To look upon God as mother and ourselves as child, for instance, gives us in that communion so much joy which cannot be expressed. It is so wonderful. So the devotee still remains separate from God. Just as Jesus said, I and my Father are one, still I am the son of my Father. Ramakrishna Paramahansa realized his identity with the Kali in his inner impersonal aspect, but still you see, he wanted to remain a child and a son of the mother. In that thing, see, that relationship, he was able to talk so sweetly about her, so lovingly about her, and enjoy the bliss of that talk. Otherwise, you lose yourself in him, and you are lost completely, and there is that sweet communion denied to you. Therefore, in the parabhas, they say, this jnanottara bhakti is called, a bhakti which comes to you after your realization of the unmanifest divine, in which you lose your individuality altogether, and even after that you maintain a thin partition between yourself and God, and then talk of him, think of him, serve him in so many ways, and enjoy the bliss of that union.
Ah, 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 ah.
Ramdas is going to speak to you a few words about grace. Without grace, nothing can be done by us. Many people think we are moving, doing everything by our will and strength. This is perfectly false. It is divine grace alone, by divine power alone, we are doing everything. Since we do not know that the divine grace is working through us, and we are able to do things, we are doing wrongly. Since the grace flows, the divine power flows through the ego, our actions, our thoughts, our feelings get contaminated. When we clear out the ego sense in us and allow God's power and grace to flow through us, then we become conscious that we are not the doers, but divine power and grace are the doer. When our mind turns towards God, it is by grace alone it turns towards God and begin to feel that the grace is there, and therefore our minds have gone towards God. Otherwise, how could it be possible for us by our own efforts to turn our mind towards God? It's not at all possible. We are not remembering or conscious of Him for several years of our life. Suddenly a day comes when our mind turns towards Him. It is He who has turned the mind towards Him, and not we. We may attribute to our past karma, past sadhanas and all that, but does not know whether this is true or false. But this much He knows, that by divine grace alone that He is drawing us towards Him. And it's rightly said by a devotee, "O God, I remember you because you remembered me first." Had He not remembered us, it would never have been possible for us to remember Him. So His grace must work in us, so as to make us walk towards Him, enable us to seek Him. Even the first inkling of a desire to seek Him comes into our mind by His grace. And if you want to make the grace work more and more in us, we must contact a saint. And that saint very often is your guru, who helps you in every way to make you fully conscious of the grace that is working in you. When you are becoming more and more conscious of the grace working in you, you know that you are merely an instrument that God is making you do everything. When Ramdas started in the first pilgrimage, he felt, you see, that God actually possessed him. And he was doing everything for him. Ramdas was not conscious that he was doing anything. People asked him, you see, why have come? God brought me that where I have come. Why are you doing that? God makes me do that thing. Later on, you begin to feel God makes me talk, God makes me walk, talk, do everything. When this consciousness fully dawns on you, the grace has come to you in all its fullness, in all its entirety. And you begin to feel you are nothing and God is everything. This supreme state, you see, can be got only through God's grace and Guru's grace. God and Guru are not different. Many people think because you see a saint or a guru whom you have accepted in human form, he is only a human being. No. You are the God who has awakened you from within, has come before you in human form to guide you further in the path, to give you the necessary strength, infuse into you the spiritual power, so that your faith may be accelerated when you are marching on the path to reach Him and have Him fully how? By realizing the fullness and supremacy of grace in you, over you. The surrender comes automatically by the grace. Gradually, as the grace begins to work in you and you are becoming more and more conscious of it, your ego sense leaves you. Just as the light coming into the room dispels darkness, so when grace enters your heart, both from outflowing from within and coming from without, while flowing feeling from the God within you and coming from without, from the God without you, because they are not different. The combined grace that removes all the obstacles from the way, destroys the ignorant dark of ignorance in you, and makes you a fully illumined being, spiritually illumined, elevated, enlightened, liberated being. So grace is everything that is needed. And by the contact of saints only, we can, in some cases, when God has not awakened us within, by the contact of saints, we are really awakened. Casually meet a saint, at once our hearts are changed. That is the experience of so many. They never went to see to get any grace from a saint. Suddenly, in his presence, you see, you are a changed person. From that time, your life is changed. Your ambition is changed. You have the ambition for so many things of the world that vanished. Your one ambition and aspiration is to realize God and know God. This awakening comes to you by merely contact of a saint, whom you thereafter accept as your guru. So grace alone can save us. There's no other way. Grace is so powerful, it does not mind to see whether the person on whom it falls is fit or unfit. If the fitness is the criterion for the working of grace in us, then grace is not all-powerful. We can say by our own efforts we gain, by our own punya or merit that we have gained, what we should gain. Grace must be so powerful that it must make the unfit fit to receive. And so we must turn our mind towards Him through His grace only, by having contact of saints. Then grace will take us up, God will take us up. Just like a baby crying if he is taken up by the mother. So we simply have to cry, "Oh God, lead me towards you. Make me feel your presence within me. Make my mind always remember you." If we pray that way, at once God, grace must come to you if we are sincere and earnest in our cry for Him. Then necessarily we will come in contact with the saint who will shower his full grace on us and thoroughly awaken us within and guide us on the path. This is inevitable because the grace is so powerful. We must only, when we go to the saints, to meet saints, keep the window of our heart open so that the influence of them may enter into us and dispel darkness and give us inner illumination. This is what we want. We must go to saints in all humility, not with discursive and critical mind. That we must leave behind. We must go with full faith, and then we are bound to receive the light that we seek from Him. And we will be guided mysteriously from within. Ramdas felt, you see, after he received the grace of the Guru with the mantra, he felt that he was not a matter. He was not doing anything by himself. Some power within him was guiding him, making him do everything. He had gone all over India, as he must have read in the book, in the first of God. Like an automaton, whoever called him, he went with him. Whoever made him sit, he sat. He never cared to see who asked him, what sort of person he is. He looked upon everybody as a manifestation of his beloved Ram. In that way he was guided from within and without. Because within in the world he was seeing the same truth, same beloved. And he never felt that he was doing anything by himself. Some higher power, some powerful being was guiding him, having possessed him. And taken him entirely into his being. Into his, protection. And was doing everything for him. For that grace is necessary. Suddenly a change came in Ramdas' life and transformed his life completely. Not by his effort. He looks back whether he had done anything to merit it. No, grace is the only thing. Ramdas can tell you a song of a northern India devotee in which he says to God, "Oh God, are you a shopkeeper? I should perform japa 300 million times and you will give me darshan. That means I have to labor hard in order to get your grace and darshan. This is like a shopkeeping business. You give something in the shop and you get something in exchange. Are you a shopkeeper?" A man engages a laborer and makes him toil in his garden for the whole day and gives him, say, 4 rupees or 400 francs, what do you call it, or 300 francs. Is it a grace that he is giving, or he is giving for what he has earned? If the master says that he has given this grace, no, I have worked hard from morning to evening, these are my wages. Grace must be given spontaneously without our doing anything for it. This is grace. So, God, I won't do anything, give me grace. Then you are really gracious. The devotee says, I won't do anything. If you say, I must toil hard, do tapasya, this and that, and you will give darshan, you are a shopkeeper. This is the, like my earning wages from you. Then where is the question of grace there? Grace must flow out of him, see, out of compassion, kindness, love for us. Not that I would toil for it. Therefore he says it is grace, is everything, and it must come to us without doing anything to deserve it. Ramdas never said that he deserved it in any way when he received it. It's pure compassion of God that made him give it.
तेरे हवाले प्रभु इसे पग पग तू ही संभाले मेरा जीवन तेरे हवाले प्रभु इसे पग पग तू ही संभाले
I'm gonna
तेरे हवाले प्रभु इसे पग पग तू ही संभाले मेरा जीवन तेरे हवाले प्रभु इसे पग
पग. A little, just a few words more, because we must throw some light further upon this very question, and that is this. Now this question naturally arises, where is the place for sadhana? A poet, by aspirants who are struggling to realize God, why should they undertake any spiritual discipline? If everything depends upon grace, and grace alone can liberate us, then where is the place of sadhana, where does it come in? Sadhana is performed to know, by sadhana we cannot attain God.
Very well said.
So long as ego sense persists, we have not reached Him. And ego sense, it is that makes us struggle hard and try to reach Him. As we go on struggling and struggling, we find our, for instance, if you want to concentrate our mind, we apply so many methods. And after all, we find the mind is as restless as ever. You sit for meditation, mind is wandering in 1,001 directions. We apply so many methods, it may seem to be under your control for a second, and next moment it's somewhere else. By that you come to know by your effort nothing can be done. You feel helpless at the end of your sadhana, and then what you do? Surrender. I am not your God, you are everything. He comes to that stage. By struggling hard for some time, he lets go the struggle and surrender himself to God, and then he gets what he wanted. The end of sadhana consists in stopping sadhana at a certain stage, knowing that you are perfectly helpless. And He is your helper. He is called Anandashram. Anandashram means helper of the helpless. He can be your helper only when you are fully conscious that you are helpless. Helpless you become after struggling for a long time and find nothing is been done. You are far away from Him, as far away as ever. Then what you do? Surrender yourself. You know your own weaknesses, you know your own nothingness, so to say, and your own powerlessness. In that condition it is that you surrender. That condition is attained by struggling hard to get Him. And who is struggling? The ego is struggling. And this struggle makes the ego know in course of time that it's helpless and nothing. Because it starts with the assumption that by its struggle it will be able to concentrate the mind, free ourselves from our desire, and reach God. All right, go on. Give him a long rope. Let him struggle on. Struggle and struggle. At the end of the struggle, he finds he has not achieved anything. So he bends down before God and says, God, you are everything, I am nothing. I have found out that by my power I am unable to achieve you or to attain you. So I have come in complete surrender to you, and now yours is to liberate me, save me, grant me your darshan. Just as a man, you see, when he wants to hit a certain mark, he takes the bow in hand and sets to it an arrow. He goes on, you see, he aims at it and takes the arrow in his hand and then pulls that bow and the string to a needed stretch. If he goes on pulling and pulling and pulling without releasing the arrow, it won't hit the mark. So what we are doing is, we are pulling and pulling and pulling and never allowing the arrow to hit the bow, hit the mark. You must release it. So struggle hard and then let go. Leave it to Him.
That's a trick.
You are everything, I am nothing, O God. My struggle is useless. By my struggle I cannot achieve anything. I have come to know by this method of sadhana, I have come to know I am nothing. Sadhyamanekam sharanam raya. Giving up every path, every effort, every struggle, I come to you in perfect surrender. Oh God, save me. He says, if you come to me in that state, I will liberate you from all sins. I will give you the highest beatitude.
This is the assurance of God. That means what he demands of us is surrender. When we refuse to surrender, make him toil day and night until he gets exhausted and feels I have nothing.
Tired horse.
Huh?
A tired horse. Like
a tired horse. Collapses.
Collapses.
रामदासा तव शरणं सद्गुरुनाथा तव शरणं
रामदासा तव शरणं
दीनदयाला दीनोदारा तव शरणं
दीनानाथा दीनदयाला दीनोदारा तव शरणं
ॐ श्रीराम जय जय राम श्रीराम जय राम पतित पावन तव शरणं करुणासागर तव शरणं
पतित पावन तव शरणं करुणासागर तव शरणं
गौरवर्णा हास्य मधुर प्रिया भक्तवत्सल तव शरणम् अनाथरक्षक तव शरणम्
भक्तवत्सल तव शरणम् अनाथरक्षक तव शरणम्
तपोराशि रम्यमूर्ति आनन्दमूर्ति तव शरणम् तपोराशि रम्यमूर्ति आनन्दमूर्ति तव शरणम् ॐ श्रीराम जय राम जय जय राम श्रीराम जय राम जय जय राम
ॐ श्रीराम जय राम जय जय राम श्रीराम
विघ्ननाशन तव शरणं भवभयहरणा तव शरणं
विघ्ननाशन तव शरणं भवभयहरण तव शरणं
भक्तोद्धारा करुणा सिन्धु
भक्तोद्धारा करुणा सिन्धो दीनबन्धो तव शरणम्
ॐ श्रीराम जय जय राम ॐ श्रीराम जय राम जय जय राम
श्रीराम
ತಾರಕ ತವ ಶರಣಂ ತ್ಯಾಗಮೂರ್ತಿ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ಭಕ್ತ ತಾರಕ ತವ ಶರಣಂ ತ್ಯಾಗಮೂರ್ತಿ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ದಿವ್ಯಮೂರ್ತಿ ಶಾಂತಮೂರ್ತಿ ಜ್ಞಾನಮೂರ್ತಿ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ದಿವ್ಯಮೂರ್ತಿ
ಶಾಂತಮೂರ್ತಿ ಜ್ಞಾನಮೂರ್ತಿ
ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ರಾಮ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಓಂ
ಶ್ರೀ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಶ್ರೀ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ಜಯ ರಾಮ
ಮುಕ್ತಿ ದಾತ ತವ ಶರಣಂ ಆನಂದ ದಾತ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ಮುಕ್ತಿ ದಾತ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ಪ್ರೇಮದಾತಾ ಜ್ಞಾನದಾತಾ ಶಾಂತಿದಾತಾ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ಪ್ರೇಮದಾತಾ ಜ್ಞಾನದಾತಾ ಶಾಂತಿದಾತಾ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ಓಂ ಶ್ರೀ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಶ್ರೀ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ಜಯ ರಾಮ
ಶ್ರೀ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಶ್ರೀ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ರಾಮ ಜಯ ಜಯ ರಾಮ
ರಾಮದಾಸ ತವ ಶರಣಂ ಸದ್ಗುರುನಾಥ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ರಾಮದಾಸ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
ಸದ್ಗುರುನಾಥ ತವ ಶರಣಂ
He said, Prabhupada was not feeling well. He wanted to take some hot water to give my hot fermentation in the hot water bag. So I also rushed to Prabhupada to find out what was wrong. Prabhupada asked me to sit by his side. He said, Ramdas is feeling a set of breathlessness. Then he said, I'll check the blood pressure first. And I got up and took the blood pressure instrument. By the time he wanted to go to the WC, he was taken, helped up to the door. Mataji took him inside. Though Mataji was weak, she wanted to see that he was helped. He had a motion, rather a bulky motion, you can say. And after the motion, he was completely exhausted. Even it was found difficult to get up. Then Mataji called me also to open the door, went inside, lifted him. And he was taken to the bed by both of us. He laid himself. There was no discomfort in the chest or anywhere. Stomach, discomfort in the stomach. So hot water bag was applied. The fermentation. No relief. He was lying down. Another 2 minutes he was sitting up. Again lying down. Again sitting up. Only chanting, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Hare Ram. Hare Ram, that's all. No message, nothing of sort. We were asking if he felt any pain anywhere. No pain, only discomfort in the stomach. Nearly 45 minutes after that, Dr. Hugo, who had gone away, came there and found, he said that, and he thought that it was again stomach trouble only. Gave some medicine for stomach, then it struck him. It was the heart trouble. Such a trouble, which never showed any indication in the chest. No pain anywhere. No other symptom. Except the discomfort in the stomach. By 7 or soon after 7, he stopped breathing. Stopped saying Hare Ram, Hare Ram. Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram. Mataji was sitting by his side and massaging his legs. Quite a number of devotees were present in that room. During the last scene, it was a shock for everybody. More so for Mataji, in that delicate health. She didn't speak a word. He went on massaging Gopal's legs. In the meantime, knowing what had happened and accepting the inevitable, we had to take further action to arrange for what should be done next. We sent messages to different places for the Mahasamadhi, got some flowers from different places. Seeing all these things going on, Mataji was more upset. We didn't know the reason at that time, but she was feeling very, very bad. The night went, nobody had sleep at night, everybody was chanting Ramna. Early morning, till morning, Mataji was massaging the legs. 6 o'clock she got up, was about to go to the bathroom, where I met her. That time she broke down. She could not control herself. Then I asked, naturally, I also could not speak. She could not speak. We stood for a few minutes, then controlling ourselves, said, I was not happy that you all accepted that Papa had gone away. If all of you had real love and devotion for him, you should have all taken Ramana and prayed to Papa to return to the body if he had left it. I was stunned. And I said, Mataji, I didn't know it was possible at all. When it was announced that he had left the body, I never thought he could come back. There is lack of devotion. She believed it because in the case of Swami Sitaroda in Hubli, it seemed the Swami went into a trance and it was taken that he had attained Samadhi. Then all the devotees started chanting Shivanam, as Shivanam was his favorite name. And after 10 or 12 years, he regained consciousness. So remembering that, he thought that would be possible here also. Perhaps if he had done it, he would have come back, but we didn't do it, so he didn't come back. That feeling she had. Then I said, I apologize. We do not possess so much love and devotion to expect that he would come back if we prayed. Then I asked her, perhaps if you had given us a hint, we would have all prayed together. How can I give you a hint when you have no devotion? How can I create the devotion in you? That was her feeling. Anyway, that had to be accepted. Then she said, where are we going to arrange for the cremation? Then she showed the place. She said, in that open ground, which was open ground at that time, from the gate up to Narasimha house, plain ground. She said, in that ground, you can arrange for the cremation. He said, all right. And I went there, selected this particular spot, which is not in the center, but on the eastern side. I was prompted to select that spot. And devotees came in the morning from different places, bringing firewood sufficient for the fire. So by afternoon, everything was ready. But many devotees were coming from Bombay, and we thought we should rather wait for them till evening or till next morning. Till by next morning, many devotees who could possibly come had arrived. And the cremation was to take place by about 10 o'clock Monday morning. When everything was arranged, the body was given a bath, new clothes were put on, and Mataji did not want the body to put on the usual pyre, usual, what do you call it, that structural like thing that carries the body. She didn't want that. She wanted Papa to be carried on the cot, and with the bed and other things he was usually using. So he was carried like that to the place where the cremation was arranged. She came with the body, and when she saw the spot was towards the eastern end of the Maidan, she was a little upset. Why did you not arrange in the center? She said, I could not reply. I only said I was prompted to select this spot. So she kept quiet after that. And I knew that she was not happy because it was not in the center. But nothing could be done, everything was arranged. Body was put on the pile with the mattress, with the bed sheets and with everything that he was using before. She didn't want the body to be put on plain sandalwood. She wanted that to be soft. As usual, the pyre was set fire to, and Mataji waited there till 6 o'clock in the evening, because she took an unusually long time to catch fire, as the mattress and the bed sheets and the carpet and that thing below could not allow the fire to come up to the body. So we went use more and more firewood, more and more ghee and sugar to increase the fire. Anyway, till 6 o'clock it was burning. By 6 o'clock everything was over, body has completely got burnt off. And then Mataji was requested to go to the bhajan hall. You can imagine, she had not taken any food the previous day or this day. She was starving.
Prema Murti Ramdas Mere Man Me Aa Raha. Prema Murti Ramdas Mere Man Me Aa Raha. Pyare Pyare Shabd Tere Man
Yeah.
गुरु बिना